Do you ever find yourself overwhelmed with all the busyness life throws at you? Maybe you work 40, 50, 60 hours a week at your job. Maybe you're building a business on the side. Maybe you own a business with plenty of employees, and the business requires a decent amount of your time to be successful. Maybe you're a stay-at-home mom who chases a two-year-old around all week. Regardless of how many kids you have, whether you're married, whether you have a job or run a business, you need some time off from time to time to rest. Yahweh knew this from the beginning. Our bodies naturally need rest to function properly. If you don't get enough rest, eventually it will catch up to you. I've been keeping the weekly Sabbath for over 15 years, the time of this recording. I have trouble remembering how life was before I started keeping Sabbath. I even make periodic comments to other believers about how I don't even know how I did it before keeping the weekly Sabbath. I just don't remember. Been so long. Sabbath is such a blessing. Can I get an amen? Anyone who has kept it for more than a couple weeks would agree. There are people out there who teach that keeping the law in the Old Testament is a curse. Please explain to me how taking a day off from work and all your worldly pursuits and resting is a curse. I can wait. So let's look at the origins of the Sabbath. Let's go all the way to the beginning. Genesis chapter 2, 1 through 3. Thus the heavens and the earth were completed in all their array. I know this is not a scriptural cosmology teaching, but this is evidence in scripture to disprove ever-expanding universe taught by mainstream science. And on the seventh day, Elohim completed his work, which he had made, and he rested on the seventh day from all his work, which he had made. And Elohim blessed the seventh day and set it apart because on it he rested from all his work, which Elohim in creating had made. Now, did the creator of heaven and earth need a day to rest? No. Could he have created the heavens and the earth in a shorter time period than 6 days? Of course. He was establishing the order of operation with the week of creation, the original week. He laid out a pattern and example for his people to follow by resting on the seventh day. The first documented example of Yah's people observing the Sabbath appears all the way back in Exodus 16 in the wilderness after they were delivered from slavery in Egypt. Yahweh had to teach his people his ways and help them unlearn the pagan worship practices they learned in Egypt. One of the first things they were taught was the weekly Sabbath. He used the manna to bring this point across. So let's go to look at Exodus 16, 23 through 31. And he said to them, this is what Yahweh has said. Tomorrow is a rest, a Sabbath set apart to Yahweh. That which you bake, bake, and that which you cook, cook. And lay up for yourselves all that is left over, to keep it until morning. And they laid it up till morning, as Moses commanded. And it did not stink, and no worm was in it. And Moses said, eat it today, for today is a Sabbath to Yahweh. Today you do not find it in the field. Gather it 6 days, but on the seventh day, which is the Sabbath, there is none. And it came to be that some of the people went out on the seventh day to gather, but they found none. And Yahweh said to Moses, how long shall you refuse to guard my commands and my Torah, which is plural for Torah. Anybody not familiar with the word Torah? It just means teachings or instructions. See, because Yahweh has given you the Sabbath, therefore he has given you bread for 2 days on the sixth day. Let each one stay in his place. Do not let anyone go out of his place on the seventh day. So the people rested on the seventh day, and the house of Israel called its name manna or manah. And it was like white coriander seed, and the taste of it was like thin cakes made with honey. I enjoy honey, so I probably would enjoy this. This is one example of Yahweh's commands being observed before the tablets were given in Exodus 20 on Mount Sinai. That's a very interesting fact. It was that important for Yahweh to teach ancient Israel Sabbath observance, even before he gave his instructions to his servant Moses. Just how important is Sabbath? Let's look in Exodus 31, 12 through 17. And this talks about Sabbath being the sign for Yahweh and his people. And Yahweh spoke to Moses, saying, and you speak to the children of Israel, saying, my Sabbaths you are to guard by all means. Now this is talking about the weekly Sabbath. This referring to the feast too. For it is a sign between me and you throughout your generations, to know that I, Yahweh, am setting you apart. You shall guard the Sabbath, for it is set apart to you. Everyone who profanes it shall certainly be put to death, for anyone who does work on it, that being shall be cut off from among his people. 6 days work is done, and on the seventh is a Sabbath of rest set apart to Yahweh. Everyone doing work on the Sabbath day shall certainly be put to death. Serious business, folks. And the children of Israel shall guard the Sabbath to observe the Sabbath throughout their generations as an everlasting covenant. Everlasting, aka forever. Between me and the children of Israel, it is a sign forever. For in 6 days, Yahweh made the heavens and the earth, and on the seventh day he rested and was refreshed. The Sabbath is the sign between Yahweh and his people. But for how long? Scripture clearly shows it's throughout your generations. We can easily interpret this as forever. Breaking Sabbath is one of the few death penalty offenses in the Torah. Yahweh takes observing his set apart days and Sabbath very seriously. Sabbath is a sign between Yahweh and his people forever. If you don't observe the Sabbath, what does that mean? So now I want to look at some false teachings regarding the Sabbath. The false teaching number one. There's some false teachings out there about Yahshua's death and how it did away with the Torah of Yahweh. So is that scriptural? Let's see. We're going to go to Luke 23, 46 through 56. And crying out with a loud voice, Yahshua said, Father, into your hands I commit my spirit. And having said this, he breathed his last. And the captain, seeing what took place, praised Elohim, saying, Truly, this man was righteous. And when all the crowds who had gathered to that sight saw what took place, they beat their breasts and went away. And all those who knew him and the women who followed him from Galilee stood at a distance, watching this, and see a man named Joseph, a council member, a good and righteous man. He was not agreeing with their council indeed, from Arimathea, a city of the Jews, who himself was also waiting for the reign of Elohim. He going to Pilate, asked for the body of Yahshua. And taking it down, he wrapped it in linen and laid it in a tomb hewn out of the rock where no one was yet laid. And it was preparation day, and the Sabbath was approaching. And the women who had come with him from Galilee followed after and saw the tomb and how his body was laid. And having returned, here's the key, they prepared spices and perfumes, and they rested on the Sabbath according to the command. Know the teaching that Yahweh's Torah was done away with when Yahshua Messiah died is not scriptural. There were still believers observing Yahweh's Sabbath after Yahshua died. There's tons of examples in the book of Acts of Sabbath observance. That's so easy to find. So false teaching number two, since I'm a Gentile, I do not have to keep the Sabbath. So let's go to Isaiah 56, 6 and 7. Also, the sons of the foreigner who join themselves to Yahweh to serve him and to love the name of Yahweh, to be his servants, all who guard the Sabbath. There you go. And not profane it, and hold fast to my covenant. Them I shall bring to my set apart mountain, and let them rejoice in my house of prayer. Their burnt offerings and their slaughterings are accepted on my altar. For my house is called a house of prayer for all the peoples. For who? All the peoples. Sons of the foreigner means those who are not natural born Israelites or Gentiles. Anyone can be grafted into the tree of Israel and observe the Torah. Paul also talked about the same concept in Romans 11, being grafted in. So now let's take a look at Sabbath observance in Nehemiah's time. So let's go to Nehemiah 13, 15 to 21. In those days, I saw in Judah those treading wine presses on the Sabbath and bringing in sheaves, loading donkeys with wine, grapes, and figs, and all kinds of burdens, which they brought into Jerusalem on the Sabbath day. So I warned them on the day they sold food, and men of Zoar dwelt there, bringing in fish and all kinds of goods, and sold them on the Sabbath day to the children of Judah. How about them apples? And in Jerusalem, then I contended with the nobles of Judah and said to them, What evil matter is this that you are doing, profaning the Sabbath day? Did not your fathers do the same so that our Elohim brought all this evil on us and on this city? Yet you bring added wrath on Israel by profaning the Sabbath. And it came to be at the gates of Jerusalem, as it began to be dark before the Sabbath, that I commanded the gates to be shut, and commanded that they should not be opened till after the Sabbath. And I stationed some of my servants at the gates, so that no burdens will be brought in on the Sabbath day. And the merchants and sellers of all kinds of wares spent the night outside Jerusalem once or twice. And I warned them and said to them, Why do you spend the night around the wall? You do so again, I lay hands on you. From that time on, they came no more on the Sabbath. The appropriate question we should all ask now is, should we buy or sell on the Sabbath? I'm gonna go out on a limb and say no. Nehemiah knew the practice was wrong and sinful. Sabbath is a day of rest from work, but it's also a day that is set apart for Yahweh. Our focus should be on Him. Our thoughts and actions should be set apart, just like the day is set apart. It's challenging at times to keep our thoughts set apart on Sabbath. Don't worry, got a solution for you. Let's go to 2 Corinthians 10, 4 and 5. For the weapons we fight with are not fleshly, but mighty in Elohim. We're overthrowing strongholds, overthrowing reasonings and every high matter that exalts itself against the knowledge of Elohim. Taking captive every thought to make it obedient to the Messiah. Anytime you find yourself thinking unclean thoughts or thoughts that are not set apart on Sabbath, just quote the fifth verse of this passage. And really, any day of the week, if you have unclean thoughts, you can do that. Also ask Yahweh to help keep your thoughts set apart and focused on Him. Boom, shakalaka. There you go. Problem solved. But what about Yahshua and the Sabbath? You should always look the example on everything. When you don't know how to do something, it's always a great idea to look to Messiah Yahshua's example to see how He lived His life and how He handled different situations. Did the Messiah of the Scriptures observe the weekly Sabbath? Before I answer that question, I want to share some very important verses regarding Yahshua. 1 John 2, 3-6. And by this we know that we know Him if we guard His commands. The one who says, I know Him, and does not guard His commands is a liar, and the truth is not in him. But whoever guards His word, truly the love of Elohim has been perfected in him. By this we know that we are in Him. The one who says he stays in Him ought himself also to walk even as He walked. So according to verse 6 here, we're supposed to follow Yeshua's example. So let's see another verse about Yahshua and the Sabbath. Mark 2, 27, 28. And He said to them, the Sabbath was made for man, and not man for the Sabbath. So the son of Adam is also the master of the Sabbath. The Sabbath was made for man means man should keep it. The son of Adam is also master of the Sabbath means exactly what it says. Yahshua was on another spiritual level than us, which is why He is worthy of titles like son of Adam. It's also why He's considered master of the Sabbath. So let's look at a couple verses in Luke chapter 4, 15 and 16. And He was teaching in their congregations, being praised by all. And He came to Nazareth, where He had been brought up. According to His practice, He went into the congregation on the Sabbath day and stood up to read. But we can see a couple things from these verses. First, He stood up to read, means Yahshua taught on the Sabbath, most likely from the Torah. They were not reading the New Testament back then. New Testament is about all their lives they were living. Second, He observed Sabbath with a body of believers. Very important. If we can, I know it's not possible or practical, however you want to put it, for all the believers around the world to be able to meet with other believers on Sabbath on a consistent basis. But if you're able to, you should. Being around other believers is so important. Iron sharpens iron. You'll get challenged on your beliefs. You'll grow. If you have good, loving brothers and sisters around you, you spend time with them. So what about the phrase first day of the week in the New Testament? So everywhere you see the phrase first day of the week in the New Testament writings, it refers to the first day of the week, of course, and the Sabbath is referred to as the seventh day of the week. This fact is important because the first day of the week is not when the Sabbath should be observed. So in the King James Version of Matthew 28:1, it reads, in the end of the Sabbath, as it began to draw or dawn toward the first day of the week, came Mary Magdalene and the other Mary to see the sepulcher. And then the ISR, which all the other verses are, same verse, Matthew 28:1. Now after the Sabbath, toward the dawn of the first day of the week, Mary from Magdala and the other Mary came to see the tomb. It is a common Christian tradition to have sunrise services on Sunday morning. But if you research the origins of this practice, you'll find they are pagan, not scriptural. The following verse is why people attend sunrise services: to celebrate a risen Savior in an empty tomb. Now I'm on board with a risen Savior, but I can't get on board with sunrise services. I prefer to avoid pagan traditions like the plague. So let's look at Matthew 12:40. For as Jonah was 3 days and 3 nights in the stomach of the great fish, so shall the Son of Adam be 3 days and 3 nights in the heart of the earth. People observe Good Friday because of another tradition practiced in Christianity. Folks believe Messiah Yahshua was killed and buried on Friday. Here's the problem with that. A Friday burial and a Sunday morning resurrection make for bad math. According to the preceding verse, you don't get 3 days and three nights. The space between these two events does not add up to 3 full days and 3 full nights. If the two Marys went to a tomb on Sunday morning, or the first day of the week on the morning, and the tomb was empty, a Wednesday burial would have been more mathematically accurate. There's not a single verse in the whole New Testament that proves there's accuracy in assuming Yeshua was buried on a Friday. So I know everyone that observes Sabbath has different convictions about it. But for me, there's certain things that I consciously choose not to do on Sabbath, so I can keep my thoughts and actions set apart. You may disagree, that's okay. I just want to share what I do and maybe help somebody else or not. So right now I have Facebook on my phone or Messenger. I just, when I post on Facebook or I look at it for whatever reason, I look at it on my laptop because I realized a couple years ago that I was making an idol, a mighty one, out of my phone. I was spending way too much time on my phone. And so deleting Facebook and Messenger off my phone made too much sense. Had more time, had more peace. It was a good thing. I'm not telling people, I'm talking to grown folks here, so I'm not telling anybody not to get on Facebook. I'm just telling you what I do and don't do on Sabbath. Try my best to keep Sabbath apart and please it to the Father. So one thing I don't do, if I can help it, and I started this years ago, is get on Facebook on Sabbath. I know there's a lot of people that will post scriptures and they'll say, and they'll get defensive about that comment. They'll say, oh, I post scripture and I get on my friends' posts and read their scriptures. But here's the problem though. If you're looking at Facebook on your phone and you're scrolling, I mean, you might see a couple scriptures, but within 30 seconds, a minute, or whatever, you're gonna scroll past the ad. And these marketing companies know what they're doing. They know what you search online and they target off of that. So these are very targeted ads toward your likes. So when you see that ad, it takes your mind off of Abba and onto something else, onto something that you like that might not be appropriate to be looking at on Sabbath. I'm not telling nobody not to get on Facebook on Sabbath. I'm just telling you what I do. But if somebody later on sees me upload a teaching on Sabbath or something, they're like, ah, you're on Facebook. I try not to be. And something else I don't do is check my email. I mean, I can wait another day. The inbox will be there waiting on me with emails that I want and I don't want. And another thing I don't do is go to the mailbox. Snail mail, as they call it. I can wake up, check that after Sabbath is over, no problem. Stuff will be there waiting on me. So if you're new to Sabbath observance, I challenge you to really, if you're researching, I challenge you to really look into it. It's such a blessing. It will draw you closer to the Father. You'll have better health. Just like the dietary laws are good for our health, because He created our bodies, He knows better than us. Keeping Sabbath is good for your health too. So this video was a blessing. Do me a favor, share it. And if you haven't already subscribed to the channel, I don't bite. It don't cost you anything to subscribe. So if this was a blessing, hit that share button. Post it on Facebook if you want to. But like I always like to end, get your scriptural shovel out and keep digging into the Most High's word. Shalom.